hallelujah. The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. Tremble at his voice, tremble at your voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? All will see how great is our God. The splendor of the King,
the splendor of the King, clothed in majesty.
Let all the earth,
let all the earth rejoice.
Everything we do is all about you. We love you.
Oh.
Splendor of the King. Oh,
we worship you.
Clothed in majesty, we worship you. Let all the earth.
How great thou art.
Then sings my soul. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you for your love, God. Hallelujah.
Spirit, lead me where my trust is without.
The one who sees
a need and always provide. I am the one whose name is a tower where you can run and hide. I am he who has all power in my head. I'm talking about God. If you believe on his word, you can stand, for he is healer, mender of broken hearts. Just let me be who I am to you. That's who I am. Just let me be who I am. To you. That's who he is. your name, God. Hey. Hey, God. For you move mountains. You cause walls to fall with your power. Perform miracles. There is nothing that's impossible. And we're standing only because.
Only because you made a way.
And we're standing only because.
Only because you made
it. And we're standing
way.
Right here.
And we're standing
only because.
Only because.
Thank you, God.
You
and we're standing here.
And we're standing
only
here.
Because.
Only because. Life.
to your name, God.
If it's not glorifying the name of Jesus, what good is it? My God, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus.
Say I am strong. Let the poor say
give thanks.
You just want to tell you that I love you, love you, love you, love you, love you, love you, love you more than anything, God.
I love you, Jesus.
I worship and adore you.
I worship and adore you.
Just want to tell you.
How I need.
Can you say you love him this morning?
I love you.
Why don't you open your mouth?
With all of my heart.
What's the next chorus? It says what? I'll go. I'll do. I heard the first part. I don't think we had a whole lot of problems with it. I love you. I love you. I love you. Now maybe it was just me. Sis, maybe it was just me because I thought that I didn't hear as many saying I'll do. Was it I do? I'll do or I'll go? Both. I'll do what you want me to do and go where you want me to go. Say what you want me to say. Did it drop off? Can I ask y'all a question? Did it drop off? Now listen. Y'all might as well get ready, because it's not going to be like you thought it was going to be. But I want you to hear me. I tried to work my way through this, but I didn't make it. So just say amen. I tried to do some young man stuff. And about halfway through, my body said, so some of y'all saw our postings. I went hog hunting down in Texas. Amen. I had 2 days. Pastor Steele, I had 2 days to shoot 3 pigs. I shot all mine in 1 day. The second day was in the 60s, Pastor James, the first day. Second day, the highs were supposed to be in the 40s. When I saw my breath, I said, the next pig that walks out there, and I heard a shot, I said, somebody else is tricking me. They shooting all theirs. They're not going tomorrow, and I'm not going to be the only one that goes tomorrow. So I shot my other pig because I was cold. Then I had nothing to do. How many of you know the Lord would just set you up? And as soon as we got to the ranch, I found out the gentleman that owns the ranch is a Christian. And I found out that I thought I went hog hunting only to go down there and encourage him and him encourage me. Now I'm going to go back to where we were at a while ago. Because our guest speaker this morning is nothing. I know it was a divine appointment, none other than own Evangelist Travis. Amen. She's still our own. Amen. I was sitting out there And I said, Lord, I thank you. You have blessed me to do a lot of different things in my life that I never dreamed that I would have the opportunity to do. And you just keep showing up and being a large God. And I'm almost 70 years old. And I want to see us, before I leave here, do what we say we're going to do that lines up with us being Christians, followers of Christ, that love sacrificially. Do y'all hear me? I am sick and tired of a church that just goes through the motions. I preached a message not too long ago. If it's gonna be, it's up to me. Some of us are waiting for reconciliation and relationships, waiting for other people to say they're sorry, and I'm sick of it. If it's gonna be, it's up to me. Lose your pride. Jesus died on a cross for us, so we can love each other past our stuff. Because somebody, please hear what I'm saying to you this morning. I'm saying it out of the bottom of my heart. Somebody's got to do this thing right. Our children's lives depend on it. If we can't get it together, who's going to get it together? Who? Tell me who. I'm at a point in my life, I'm 70, I'll be 70 my next birthday. I don't care who was right or wrong. It don't matter. Families ripped apart because of isms and schisms. And we didn't talk, did we? But I already know where you're going. It does not matter. Ray Robinson, does it matter? Life is fleeting moments. We can embrace someone today, and they're gone tomorrow. What do you want the last words between you to be? We got to stop all this foolishness, church. If we that have been called to be rescuers are floundering and drowning ourselves and holding each other under the water, who can we help? Who can we help? My daughters came to me trying to deal with the women's department around the theme for this year, wanted to tie it to the theme. And I usually have gotten a theme by now. And I told them there's room at the table for all. I think that's what I told y'all, right? And then I heard the Lord say, Jubilee, Pastor James. And then I heard him just saying that there's, I didn't understand. It's just like, you know, everything, don't carry old stuff into the new year.
You see, there's a new beginning and a fresh start. That's three different things, I thought. But they all tie together. Amen. There's some stuff that we've been hanging on to we need to let go of, saints. Hello, somebody. And the Lord said, if we will, he'll give us a fresh start and a new beginning. And you don't even have to go back and try to make up for what you missed out on, because the debt has been forgiven. That's what we should carry over into our new year. Amen. Well, I heard if you hadn't been tithing, that it's too, what is somebody used to say, that there's, you add something on it. You heard that, Morris? Huh? 20%. Well, can I ask you something? Have you been struggling with 10? What are you going to do? Now you're going to do 20, right? Come on, let's be real. You know what I'm saying to us? Let's do better. Better means you start where you're at and do better. Tomorrow night, what time? 8 o'clock. Anyhow, we're going to let you go home around 10, so be with your family, celebrate your new year in. Amen. We're not going to have the typical watch night that we've had here. It's a different start of the year, a new beginning, fresh ways. That's all I'm saying to us. Now, Evangelist Travis, I expect if you have to be grandma in the house tonight, a big mama, and use the razor strap, the extension cord, and the slipper. Use it. Because there's some stuff that we just need to deal with. Amen. Now, I'm sorry. No, I'm not. No, I'm not. I don't apologize for messing up your buzz. Because listen to me. Just one more analogy. And Brother Aaron's here. He took care of me. Minister Aaron took good care of me while we were gone. But let me tell y'all something. When I was a young man, we had a truck that we had to get on for all the hunters to go out in the field. Had this little thing on the back. And I would run, hit that thing, bounce up into the truck. When I was down there, Colin, I grabbed everything I could. I was stepping on pigs' heads. I was hanging on to everything I could hang on. And it took me about 10 minutes to get off one time. And look at me. I did not care what anybody else thought about me. Y'all need to quit worrying about what other people think about you. Because there's only one that you need to be concerned about. And his name is Jesus. Do y'all hear me? Now, I'm not going to do our offering declaration. So you're going to bring your last gift of this year, possibly, unless you do something Monday night. You're going to bring it in just a few moments. Bring that gift as unto the Lord. I'm going to ask you to hold on to your gift for our speakers, which is our tradition, because we bless those that bless us. Amen. All right. And we're even going to forego all of our greetings. Look at the person next to you and say, God bless you. I love you with the love of God, and there is nothing you can do about it. So now we've taken care of that. Now, no, don't y'all leave. Don't y'all leave. Y'all got to sing them happy one more time. One more time. And that's not carjacking if I take that from her, is it? What do you call that? Will you leave it up here for me, daughter? Or leave it at the bottom of the steps? Okay, thank you. All right, you're back in our praise team's hands. Thank you, son. Excuse me from usurping your authority this morning. All right. Amen. Come on, sis. Can you do anything after I messed up?
And I love you, Lord, how I love you. I love you, Lord, how I love you. I love you, Lord, how I love you. Lord, I want to say that I love you. Ooh, Lord, I want to say that I love you. And I love you.
And I love you.
Magnify your name. Give you all the praise.
Lord,
it's all about
you.
There's no one like you.
You.
Lift our hands to you. Lift our hearts to you.
Lord,
you're so worthy, God, of our praise.
To say, Lord, I want to say that I love you.
I just want to tell you how I feel about you, God.
Lord, I want to say that I love you.
And I love you, and I love
you.
You're worthy of all praise.
Lord, how
bless
I love
your name,
you.
God.
I love you.
You're worthy of a hallelujah. Take this time to tell you how I feel about you, God. You are worthy, Lord. 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 Open up our hearts, open up our minds to receive your word this morning, God. It's all about you, God. It's all about you, God. We lift our hands to
you.
We lift our hearts.
I love you.
Have your way.
I love you.
Glory to God. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God. Glory to God. Father of glory. We come before your presence with thanksgiving. We enter your courts with praise. We thank you because this is the day that you made. And we choose to rejoice. We choose to rejoice and be glad in it. Father, we thank you for these are your people, the people that are called by your name, that you have stamped and put your stamp of approval on them. So this morning, Father, I asked you, the dream that you gave me and what you showed me, show me how to execute that you showed me. And to give you the honor, for we're here for one purpose. Those that agree said so. Amen. Hallelujah. Got a little feedback. Glory. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. This morning, I am so happy to be here. You know, I'm in love with you guys. You in love with people when you're trying to sleep. Because, you know, me and Pastor, we in the same group. I turned 70 just before he turned 70. We in the same group. So when we can find a good place in the bed and get asleep, we don't want nothing to disturb. Because sometimes if you lay on the right side, it hurts. Then you turn over and try to lay on the left side, and it hurts. So you be trying to find a spot. But when you find a good spot and can get some sleep, you really don't want to be disturbed. You want to get that sleep. But when you have a love for God, you'll have a love for God's people. And when you give yourself to God, then he has the same privilege that you had when you were married to your husband. He can wake you up at any time. At any time. And it's always yes. So this morning, I've come to you this morning, and I'm just going to say this. I didn't come to teach or preach. I came to minister love. I didn't come to teach or preach. I could teach if I want to. I could preach if I want to. Right still, we can preach if we want to. We can teach if we want to. But sometimes it's necessary just to love on the people of God. And I have been sending pastor texts, I come out of prayer and send pastor a text or whatever. But the one thing that I'm more impressed as I go to different places and teach, that people need love more than they need anything else. People are hurting. Families are hurting. And the church is the place that we're supposed to be healed. But if we're over here licking on our wounds and infecting ourselves, then we're going to infect somebody else. We're going to infect them. So this morning, I just came to give you one scripture. One scripture, and we're going to work that one scripture. Let's turn to Romans, the 12th chapter. It's the 12th verse. And you know, this is a familiar passage of scripture for all of us. Because this is where Paul started off. I beseech you, brethren, I beg you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present yourself as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable act of service. And he said, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. So you got to do some work. You got to put the work in. Because your mind doesn't get renewed just because you come into the church and just because it's mama's church or it's daddy's church. It doesn't happen like that. You can come to the altar. We can put oil on you and pray for you. You can fall out and roll across the floor. But if you don't get up and do the work. And then Paul went over into Acts to tell us how you do the work. You have to have the ministry of the word and the ministry of the prayer, a prayer. And it's like, you won't find a preacher that don't pray. You won't find a teacher that don't pray. Because when we get through studying the word, sometimes we finish studying and we're more confused than when we started studying. Amen. Now that's just real. You go like, this is Greek to me. And until you get in that place of prayer, and it's like you could be walking about doing something, and all of a sudden God had downloaded. You go like, oh, that's what that meant. So don't think that we walking around think we Einstein and we know everything. Because just because you called, you don't get a special Holy Ghost. You don't get a different Holy Ghost. You don't have a different Bible. You don't have different tests. You don't have different trials. You, as a matter of fact, if you choose the call, you're going to have more tests. You're going to have more trials. You're going to have more tribulations. And let me help you. The word tribulation means rub down with agony until you're raw. When you get through studying out in the Greek pictures, it means rub down with agony until you're raw. Now, can I ask you a question this morning? In Romans 12 and 12, I'm going to say this scripture so you can't say I didn't give you a scripture. Amen. It's so much bubbling up in my spirit, I gotta take a deep breath. It says, rejoice in hope. And do you know that the body of Christ, we act like we have no hope? And this word said, rejoice in hope. Patient in tribulation. This is powerful. Patient in tribulation. And constant in prayer. It don't mean you got an off and on button for prayer. Like your light switch. Oh, I'm going to pray today. Click it on. If you love God, you want to have victory, you're going to do what 1 Thessalonians 5 and 17 said. You're going to pray without ceasing. And I don't know about you guys, but I'm in a season of my life. I roll over in the night. And I'm praying in tongues. Sometimes just to get to the bathroom, you gotta say a prayer. Hope you don't miss nothing. Come on. This thing is getting tight, but it's serious. But guess what? You find out that you're becoming, the more you walk with God, the more dependent you become on God. And so when he told us to rejoice in hope, Paul was actually writing this because the people in Rome, they were just heathens. They were heathens, just like us. And anytime the word of God said rejoice in hope, that means there's some situations and some circumstances that are going to come up in your life that it's going to almost like it's put a siphon hose on you and suck out joy. Suck out peace. Come on, I think I'm talking to the right church. You know, and you go like, I know I love God, but I ain't feeling nothing. I am jacked, and I don't care if I'm jacked. I'm jacked. I don't know about you, but sometimes you just have to scream out, Lord, if you don't help me now, I don't mean later. I mean right now. I sat in the middle of my bed. I said, you got to help a girl out. You got to help a girl out. And I don't know. And I'm like, I was like, Paul, I pray in tongues more than most folks. But you got to help a girl out. You got to interpret this tongue so I can get up and walk this out. Because I can't see my way. But let me eat a shunda. And then he said, patient in tribulation. When the Lord asks you to rejoice in hope and patient in tribulation, you're having a situation in your life that you can't figure it out. And when the enemy really want to try to take you out, whatever affects your physical body, don't fool yourself. Whatever affects your physical body affects your mind. Affects the way you think, affects the way you perceive things, and your perception becomes your reality. And I'm not telling you something that I heard. I'm telling you what I know, what I've walked through. So I have this prayer ministry, and I have people that I've trained. I go to different churches. I have intercessors that live on the East Coast, the West Coast, the Midwest, and they're all different denominations and different churches. So, you know, with that many different pastors and that many different congregations, we all bring these congregations. And on Sunday mornings at 5:00 in the morning, we cry out to God for men of God. Because let me tell you something. People that are called now are under the greatest fire that they have ever faced in their ministry. And I was sitting behind Pastor, and I said, Lord, you're going to have to show me how to do this. And I was looking at the congregation. So you're going to have to show me how to do this. And I'm just going to tell you right now, I'm in a prophetic impression. I have to do what the Holy Spirit is telling me to do. Because whatever affects him affects the house. And I was sitting, and I was looking. And I was looking at the back of Pastor's head. Because when I came in, somebody said, where are you going to sit? Where I always sit, back behind Pastor and Lady. That's where I sit. So I'm going where I sit. That's my seat. That's my seat. But I was sitting there still, and I was listening to what this Holy Spirit was saying. And he said, look out, daughter, look. And I began to look. And I had a conversation with Kendra on Friday. And the Lord has been showing me this Leviathan. And every time I would go up to a church to do a revival, I would see the thing wrapped around the building. And I said, Lord, what is happening? He said, my church is too full of pride. Pastor told me I could pull out my razor strap. I'm not coming down there yet. He said, we too full of pride. We get sick and we don't want nobody to know we're sick. We want to keep it a secret that we sick. We want to keep it a secret that we broke. We want to keep it a secret because guess what? We don't trust each other. Because guess what? If your foot is messed up, the rest of your body sympathizes with your foot. Amen. We are a body. Amen. And if any part of the body hurts, the rest of the body's supposed to know. If you don't know how to pray, ask somebody. Amen. And let me tell you why men and women are falling. Because people don't pray. They talk about prayer. They have seminars on prayer. They have conference on prayer. But nobody's praying. Because let me tell you something. Prayer is hard work. Prayer is not the cute ministry. You don't get no trophies for prayer. You don't get no offerings for prayer. You don't get no thank yous for prayer. Because guess what? The chief intercessor is Jesus Christ. And if he calls you to the team, that's the one who's going to give you your blessing. You don't look up from it from other people. And it has to be a ministry of love. You cannot be an intercessor and don't love the people. And so as I was asking the Lord about what I was looking at, I said, you know, Lord, I'm not trying to be deep, Lord, but what am I looking at? He said, the ministry is going through a transformation. He said, and the old eagle is tired. He said, but you know about eagles. There comes a time when the eagle has to go up high to get out of danger, so he can pluck all of his feathers off because he can't soar anymore because the weight and the cares of the people has got him all clogged up. And what happens is the feathers get full of oil and get contaminated from the environment that he's been in. So your stuff be on the leaders. And I'm talking about the associates, pastors as well. Come on. Because they're walking through their own stuff. Why they helping you walk through your stuff? And what happens is the eagle's feathers. You can't even raise your wings to go to that place that you used to go. You can't even go to that high place to get a word from God. You can't even get in the spot because it's too heavy. And what happens is the eagle has to pluck his own feathers off. And all of the feathers have to come off. And then the last thing he has to do, because the man and the woman of God who are called, they are mouthpiece. Am I right? They have to break their beak. They have to break it all up. And then they have to sit on their post. And this is the way the Lord showed it to me. He said they have to sit in the place in my presence until the feathers grow back, until the strength grows back. And then they're better than they were before their feathers were ever taken off. It's renewal time still. I was praying for you, and the Lord told me to tell you, you shall not die, but you shall live, and your latter works will be greater than the works before, for you are going to get revelations that you never got before about faith. As you walk through your most arduous journey, the Lord thy God is with you. And he said to you, Pastor, he said, and the ones that are in here, and you say you associate pastors and you ministers, guess what? He needs to sit to be strengthened. To be strengthened so he can hear a word from the Lord while his feathers grow back. And if you're in the house and you say an intercessor, where you at? Are you on your post? Are you calling out their name? Are you calling out their family's name? Because if he's not renewed, your house is not renewed. Amen. I didn't come to beat up nobody. Amen. And let me tell you something. When men and women of God have to bury their loved ones, you have to pay attention to what's happening in the spirit realm. Elder James had to bury our precious sister, your wife. That's the impact. That's a hit in the gut. You had to bury your wife. All of them in the same house. Anazia is still a part of us. He buried his wife. Look at it. Look at what's going on. Look at what's going on. And they were all attached to this house. Death hits a blow to your gut. And you can pray in tongues, you can spin around, but guess what? You gotta walk through the process. You gotta walk through the process. Pastor and his wife buried their son. And let me tell you something. I buried my son. You buried your son. And let me tell you something about burying your children. When you bury your children, a part of you stops breathing. I'm just trying to help you out. A part of you stops functioning. You're going through all the motions, but part of you is just dead. And it doesn't come back until God. And you be walking around going through the motions. I did it for years. And I'm like, is something wrong with me? And the Lord said, don't pretend, but just keep on studying and keep on praying and keep on studying and keep on praying, because you will walk through the valley of shadow and death. It doesn't say you skip through it. It doesn't say you lay a blanket and have a picnic. You have to walk through it. And then Psalms 84 said, you walk through the valley of Baca, which is the valley of tears. And guess what? I don't care who you are. They can call you prophet. They can call you evangelist. They can call you pastor, teacher. They can call you whatever you want to call you. But the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 10 and 13 that there's nothing that happens to us that is not common to man. And one translation says, in the Amplified, that's not common to the human experience. But with the temptation, he makes a way of escape that you may bear it. Because one part of it says, sometimes it's beyond your resistance. But then Paul went over and he wrote and said this. And sometimes we pray it for money, but we don't pray it for when we're in mental distress. And let me tell you something. When you're sick and your body's sick or your children are sick, guess what? It's mental distress. Because guess what the enemy does? The enemy starts to beat you down with a whip over your head. You try to put your head on the pillow and get you a nap. And he's still causing you to see your coffin, causing you to see. Come on, don't try to act like he do different things. Because let me tell you, he is a bad, insidious devil. He will show you a coffin when the doctor giving you a report. Thank you, Jesus. I was in the room this morning, and the Lord told me to take authority and break off the destiny stealer in this house. Because when the enemy comes, when the enemy comes with these types of afflictions, he's coming to steal your destiny, and he don't have the right. And we also break off every demonic prediction. And we plead the blood of Jesus against every demonic prediction. Because when you go to the doctor, he gives you a demonic prediction. And it's up to you to choose if you're going to accept the doctor's prediction because he practices medicine, or you're going to sit in the presence of God and the one who created your body. And what I like about God, in 1 Corinthians 4 and 17, I think it's 14, he said, he called it a light affliction. He called our the diagnosis light afflictions. But for a moment. And then he goes on to tell us what it's going to yield: an exceeding and eternal weight of glory. And some of us, sometimes we wonder why the house or we don't have glory on us. It's because we try to not go through the test. We try to go around it. But you got to walk through it. And anything, let me help you so you can stop judging other people about what they're going through. Because anything that's not your test, then it's something they must have done wrong. Until it come to your house. Then when it come to your house, you got a different view. But let me help you with this. He says there's nothing that happens to us that's not common to man. If people in the world are getting cancer, we're going to get it. Because we're eating the same food and stuff they're eating. And might be eating more of it than they eat. People in the world are dealing with their children choosing homosexuality as a lifestyle. And then taking hormones and changing their sex. I'm dealing with people right now that call me on the phone. When your boy show up and tell you he no longer want to be a boy, but he getting ready to go and get his so he can be a girl. If you a man and your son say he want to be a girl, you can't tell me that's not mental stress. And guess what? The body of believers is going through that. Because there's nothing that happens to us that's not common to man. So we got to prepare ourselves, because guess what? We're getting ready to have a great influx of these hurting people coming into the church. And if I'm still limping when they come, then I can't help them. This is going to be a greater revival than we have ever known before. But guess what? They're going to come in. They're going to come in and they're going to look exactly like the people look coming from World War II and Vietnam. They're going to be limping. They're going to have eyes poked out. They've been on meth. They've been on crack. They mentally ill. And we got to get straight. We got to stop playing the game. We got to get straight. And let me tell you, we got to help each other. Could you come up here for a minute, Sister Kendra? It's your right side that's bad?
Both sides.
Both sides. Okay. So we're going to have to learn this. If you got a good right side and I got a good left side, then we're going to have to hook up together so we can have two good sides. So in case your right knee buckle, my right knee up. In case your other buckle, we're going to have to do that. And then every now and then, you have to do this. You have to do this. You go. And because let me tell you, when people are truly, truly hurting, they act like they don't want nobody to touch them. But I got in Brother Ray's face. I did, didn't I? I said, when I call you, you better pick up the phone. Because I made my friend a promise. You better pick up the phone. I said, because you don't want me to knock on the door and do a drive-by. Because I'm going to bring Donnell to kick down the door. Because I can't do that part. But the title of the message this morning, if we're going to get that, God will carry you. Could you put the picture up that I gave you? And this, the Lord showed me this, Pastor, when I looked at this picture. That is my granddaughter laying on her daddy's shoulder. And notice in the picture, you can't hardly see him. But look at her face. She is so at peace. And when I looked at that picture, I said, what are you telling me, Lord? He said, if you let me carry what you can't carry, then you will be at peace. He said, so it's time out for you trying to be a hero. Just say, I can't handle this. I can't handle it. My hands up. It's an act of surrender. My hands up. I can't handle this. And clam up on his shoulder and let him carry you. Because it's too much. Too much. And I'm almost finished. And I'm going to close this little paper. And where's the oil? Hallelujah. I'm coming down. Kendra, could you look in my purse and get my flat shoes, my work shoes? Because I told the Lord, if I'd have to lay hand on everything even in here, even if it's a cockroach that crawled in, it's going to get a lay, gonna get a hand laid on it.
Amen.
Mm-mm, I can stand up. I just need to take off them high steppers. Mm-hmm. Put on the work shoes. Mm-hmm. But if you're not in pain, somebody in your family is in pain. If you're not sick, somebody in your family is sick. If you're going through mental distress, somebody in your family is going through mental distress. And it's time for us to stop pretending that we are right. And you know why we can pretend? Hi, baby girl. Looking like your mama. You know why we can pretend so well? Because we have more money and credit cards than we used to have. So we can buy a look, and the look not real. Am I on the right street? I'm on the right street? They'll be carrying a $500 purse and don't have $5. Something's wrong with that picture. Something's wrong with that picture. When you would give somebody $500 for a purse and you don't have any money in the purse left, something's wrong with that picture. Something's wrong with that picture. And if you go to the house of God and the man or woman asks for an offering, you mad. And that's because you haven't paid for your purse yet. And you're paying interest on the purse that you paid $500 for. It's time for us to stop doing the nonsense. And we need to lay up something for our children. So for our children. Mm-hmm. And we need to give them Jesus. We need to give our children Jesus. Because it's time out that the saints' kids are heathens and act worse, sometimes worse than other folks' children. And it's only because we confuse them with our behavior. Because we live one way at home and a different way at church. And let me help you with somebody else. If we tear up down everybody at the church at home, they're not going to have respect for any of us. Including, they know. And I was talking to my sons, and I said, one of the greatest maladies in the African American church is we don't have a culture of honor. And it came over from the slavery mentality that we don't have the culture of honor. But that's the principle that God works on. He honors those who honor. There's a book by a guy named Danny Silk. It's called The Culture of Honor. And everybody that's on the staff, you want to make sure that they read that so they can understand. God promotes you according to how you honor. Because even our children, I said to my oldest granddaughter, smart as a whip, but got a tongue like a she know everything. She know everything. I asked her, did Trump call her up to get some information? Because she know everything. You only been living 21 years, but you know everything. And I said to her, I said, baby, let me help you. I said, you're a smart, bright young lady, but you're stupid. I said, because you're not the smartest person in the room. It's always somebody in the room smarter than you are. It's always somebody in the room more gifted than you are. There's always somebody in the room can preach better than you preach it. It's always somebody in the room can sing better than you sing it. It's always somebody that can do it better than you doing it. God don't need just you. You can drop off anytime you want to, but the show not gonna stop running. Because somebody gonna step up and do it better than you did it. But it's time for us to help each other. And it's time for us to do this. The Lord said to me one day, he said, Brenda, you have a gift of discernment. This is what I want you to start doing. And I said, what? He said, I want you to see the goal in people. Because if you haven't seen the goal in them, then you're not truly discerning. If you can only see the bad stuff, then you're not truly discerning. You're looking through your eyes. But if you look through my eyes, you're going to see what I deposited them in. And you're going to see what's wrestling with them to keep them fulfilling the purpose. And whoever you're ministering to, and whatever ministry you're in, you ask the Lord to give you the sight that you can see what he placed in them before the foundation of the world. And that's the thing that needs to be developed. And then you have the love, the hell out of them. I'm not saying a bad word. But you know, our attitudes can be very hellish. And the only way you get that out of people, you have to just love it out of them. Mm-hmm. You have to hug them when they don't want to be hugged. You have to be in their face when they don't want you to be in their face. You have to call them on the phone when they don't want to talk to you. And they'll tell you, I don't want to be bothered. I don't even like you. I didn't ask you, did you like me? Because if you minister to only people that like you and you like them, you're going to be at you and mama's house. That's as far as you're going. Because most of the people that you are called to minister to act as crazy as you do. And you know most of us, it's a piece of work. And my mother was real good at it. The badder you act, she would look at you still and say, I pray. That's what she would say. I pray that God give you your change. Mm-hmm. That means I praise that some one of your children gonna raise up and give you double for your trouble. And guess what? Most adult parents in here and tell you, we ain't got really sanctified since y'all got became adults. We can't beat y'all no more. We can't put you in time out. We can't take no money from you because we try not to give you no money. But that don't always work. Your adult children will send you to the crazy farm. For real. And the reason that they do is because they're duplicating some dumb stuff we did. It just looks different when it shows up again. And that's why we're getting so saved now. That's why we're getting so holy now. Because we see ourselves and it don't look good. And we be repenting about stuff like, oh my God, did I do? Oh my God. Oh my God. I don't know about y'all, but I be all back into my past. Oh my God. Please forgive me for that attitude. Oh my God. Oh my God. Could you wash me again, Lord? Oh my God. Oh my God. Could you help me, Lord? Oh my God. Put you could have gone to my mouth. Oh my God. And I'm just dealing with the children. But I see myself. So let me tell you something, church. We in a particular season in the body of Christ when everybody wants a title and everybody wants the position and don't nobody want to do nothing unless they have a position. But when we were coming along, if you didn't climb clean a toilet, you didn't get ordained. Because this is my philosophy. If you can't clean up their waste, then you can't mess with their life. Because they life smell worse than they waste. Huh? And Pastor Tay, I used to be fussing when I would be fussing in the old vestibule out there. Oh, I'd be fussing and steady spraying. Fussing and spraying. But it's part of it. It's part of it. So the church don't need to hire somebody to clean. The church got too many of us. It's enough of us. Amen. To keep the church clean. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of ministers in this house. Minister means servant. And servants don't get to choose their task. It's what you assigned. What's assigned to you. You can be bad at me next week, but I'll be in Columbia. And ask me if I'll be thinking about it. Mm-mm. I won't be thinking about it. I'm not going to call for a sick line because I don't believe in sick lines. I believe in healing. And the only thing we would be doing is agreeing with you. There's somebody in this house that you've been concerned about your breast. You've been concerned about it. But it's frightening you. And you don't want to go check it out. If you don't want to come, you can stay where you are. You can catch me on the fly and just pull my skirt tail, whatever. But let me say this. God wants us delivered more than we want to be delivered. God wants us to walk in the power of God. He came to get, the Holy Ghost didn't come for you to just talk in tongues. The Holy Ghost came for you to have power to live this. And then he said in Philippians 3:10, and most of the time we don't preach and teach this, Paul said this, that I may know him. And how did he want to know him? In the power of his resurrection. And if you know anything about the cross and what he went through the resurrection, you go like, why would Paul pray that? And then he went on to say, and through the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering. when you get into a real test and you're going through a real tribulation and you're really going through, then you begin to understand what Paul meant. Because that mental pressure almost wipes you out. I remember when my son was diagnosed with cancer. And it was in the last stage when they found it. And I asked the Lord a question. I said, what are you going to do? And he said, what do you want me to do? Mm-hmm. And they gave him a death sentence. They gave him a death sentence. Now, because I was a radiation therapist, I knew that the sentence, that the what they said, I knew from the scientific standpoint. But God said, you shall see my glory. You shall see my glory. Because they told me he wouldn't live but 3 months. And that he would never walk again. He walked, he ran, he played, he ate. He used to eat hot dogs and potato chips while he was taking chemotherapy. They say that's impossible. I said everything is possible with God. And he lived 2 years past the point that they said he was to live. And he didn't die in the hospital. Because my son, and my baby boy said, Mama, I said, what? Don't take me back to that place. And I made him a promise. Didn't know how I was going to fulfill it. But I made him a promise that I would never take him back to the hospital again. Didn't know how I was going to feel it still. Didn't know how. Didn't know how I was going to fulfill it. But I took him home. And I said, if he never wants to go back there, God will give me the grace and strength to take care of him. And we will never have to go back there. And we never went back there again. So you can command some things. But it still's got to be processed through the will of God. But this is the scripture that I truly love. In 1 John 5, 14 and 15, he says this. This is the confidence that I have in him. Not in me, in him. That if I ask anything according to his will, he hears me. And if I know that he hears me, then I know that he will grant the petition that I have made known unto him. So the first thing you have to do, find out what his will is on your situation. If you're sick, it's his will that you be healed. If you're having a problem with your children, it is his will that they be saved, that your whole house be saved. So anything that's the will of God, you can go in there and find the word of God to stand on the will of God, and you keep saying it till you see it. Amen. So if you want prayer, be willing. But I think we should do, have you guys heard of a fire line before? That we should just walk through them, just lay hands on them. We're not going to prophesy. We're just going to lay hands on you. But it's according to your faith. Be it unto you. According to your faith. I want to ask the question, is this helping anybody? And let's say one more thing. Because you're going through or your body is sick, it doesn't mean that you have sinned. You just happen to live in this world. And that's part of the maladies of living in this world system and eating this food. It's a systematic thing. And if you know anything about medicine, if they build a cancer center, they're going to make sure they have enough cancer patients to pay for the center. I'm just, because I remember when I was in medicine and I was over radiology, we didn't even do mammograms. In your whole career, you might do maybe one or maybe two mammograms. But the day they invented the mammogram machine, I'm just telling you how the hospital works. They invented the mammogram machine. And I had to go to Chicago to buy mammogram equipment. Then we had to sit down at the table and figure out how many people we had to give a mammogram to pay for that machine. It's called systematic. It's systematic. So if they build all these beautiful cancer centers and you go in there and you see all them beautiful flowers and the lunch, this and that, guess what? They got to have some people to pay for it.
Tell it, tell it, tell it.
you better pray over your medicine. Because if you pay attention to anything, the medicine that come out is supposed to be the wonder drug. Then 9 months later, they say, oh, your toe going to fall off. Oh, your lung going to fall off. You're going to cough up your... But they already knew you were going to cough up your lung when they gave it to you. But they wanted to make that buck. I'm telling you how it works. It's a system. It's a system. Same way with chemotherapy. I have a friend who's an oncologist, and she said, we make more money with them being on chemotherapy than on nutritional therapy. We make more money with chemotherapy because it's quick money. It's called the system. But we are citizens of another country. We're citizens of another country. And we make a choice of whose principles we're going to follow. It doesn't mean that we're not going to do some suffering. Because if you believe in God, if you believe in God for a part of your body to be healed, you got to walk out the process. And some days it's hard. Some days it's hard. Some days, I say it's two people that live in me. An old lady that's almost 70 and a young girl. Some mornings I wake up, the old lady said, I'm not going nowhere and I'm not doing nothing. That's what she said. Uh-huh. I'm not doing nothing, so you might as well put on your worship music, uh-huh. Get in your easy chair, because I'm not going nowhere. And you know what I do, Pastor? I oblige her. Because I know by her being old and cantankerous, if I give her what she wants, then when I want to make her move, then she's going to get up and move because I gave her what she wanted. Got to learn how to take care of yourself. Got to learn that you can't do everything you did before. Got to learn that your prayer is just as powerful if you're sitting down as if you're standing up. You got to learn these things. You got to learn that you can sit in the pulpit and preach just as well as stand in the pulpit. You got to learn these things. Mm-hmm. You got to learn that you can preach in tennis shoes. Mm-hmm. Tennis shoes. You can probably teach in tennis shoes. And where I go to church, I can teach in my sweatsuit if I want to. And lead prayer in my sweatsuit and tennis shoes. And guess what? I'll be powerful because I'll be comfortable. I'm just trying to help y'all. It's time for us to put all this and get to the nitty gritty. Mm-hmm. All right, so it's apparently everybody in here healed. Everybody in here whole. Everybody in here's children is doing good. Mm-hmm. You don't need no help. You don't need the Holy Ghost to do nothing for you. Now this is a powerful man of God and he walking down. But Pastor, the Lord is going to strengthen you, but he's going to renew you in just 9 months. In 9 months, they're going to look at you and say, what happened? Because all of those feathers that are full of oil and cares will be plucked out. It'll be a new beak. You'll have a new word. You'll have a new revelation. That body will be able to do the things that's in line